Public dialogue and civic engagement play an important role in improving the health and well-being of Texans across our great state. That's why Blue Cross and Blue Shield of Texas is a proud supporter of free Texas Tribune events like the conversation you're about to see.
So we'll go ahead and introduce the panel. To my left, we have State Representative Myra Crownover. She's a Republican from Denton and the chair of the House Public Health Committee. And we have Dr. Christopher Frei. He is an associate professor and division head for the Department of Pharmacotherapy, if I pronounce that correctly, at the University of Texas at Austin College of Pharmacy. And he's also a governor's appointee to the Texas Task Force on Infectious Disease Preparedness and Response. And then we have Dr. Jade Lee. She's an assistant professor of internal medicine at the University of Texas Southwestern Medical School, and if I'm not mistaken, also on the Infectious Disease Task Force. And finally, we have Zachary S. Thompson. He's director of the Dallas County Health and Human Services. So we'll go ahead and get started. I like to do these sort of like marketplace by the numbers. So just a rundown really quickly. Texas has had 231 reported cases of Zika to date. And that count includes 14 pregnant women, two infants, and two cases of sexual transmission. And earlier this year, we also reported that there had been the first Zika-related death of an infant in Harris County. That said, it's also mid-October. It's, dare I say it, starting to get pleasant again to go outside. So where are we, and just how worried should we be? And Mr. Thompson, I figured we could jump right in with you.
Well, I think I want to commend Texas Tribune for having this discussion. I think the reality is that we're going to take a lot of lessons learned from Miami-Dade. We're very fortunate that the weather is changing, but we're still in West Nile season and Zika as it relates to there has not been a localized transmission, but we still have imported cases coming to our state and, of course, Dallas County. I want to commend our cities. I have to start out by saying Bill from the city of Richardson is here. All the 25 municipalities that in Dallas County have been working on Zika response. And so we have the luxury of our major cities, we have our county commissioners that have chipped in terms of funding, but we still need to be worried because it's not if but when we'll see an actual Zika localized case in the North Texas area. And so right now we're planning for that. And again, thank God that we don't have it here as similar to what happened in Miami-Dade, but I am concerned that eventually we will see it here in the North Texas area, and how we plan is critical now. And not to prolong the piece on that is that I think it's critical that we look at what happened in Miami-Dade, we take the lessons learned, we saw what I consider to be some changes that had to be done on the fly in terms of that response. And so we have to take the lessons learned from that.
And so we're clear, Miami-Dade, we're referring to the local transmission of the Zika virus, mosquito to human, something we haven't so far seen in Texas. Dr. Lee, are you of the same mindset that it's a not an if but a when, or are you more optimistic?
So I agree, at least it's not an if but a when for the future. Most likely, as the mosquito season is dwindling down now, as the mosquito population is going down, and as it is getting cooler, it is unlikely we're going to have the large-scale, you know, epidemics that had been predicted earlier in the year. But A, the Zika virus is still spreading throughout the world. B, we are all still traveling all throughout the world to the Caribbean, to Latin America, Central America. Now we're hearing about cases in Asia. And C, we know that the mosquitoes will be coming back next season. So I agree with Mr. Thompson that we definitely need to learn the lessons from Latin America, from Puerto Rico especially, where Zika local transmission has been a huge issue, and to figure out how we can prevent that type of local transmission in the future.
Dr. Frei, if we're talking about lessons learned elsewhere, what should the state of Texas be doing that it isn't doing?
Well, just to start, I agree that we are very fortunate that we're in a preparation and planning mode because we have not experienced local transmission in Texas. And that's a good place to be. I mean, to quote Abraham Lincoln, if you give me 6 hours to cut down a tree, I'm going to spend 4 hours sharpening the axe. So that's where we are. We're really preparing. We are really getting ready for, you know, what I believe, as the two of you have said, that we will eventually experience local transmission here. So we're planning. So I think the state of Texas is doing a lot of good things to prepare. Public education campaigns, there's public service announcements that have been prepared. There are teams that have been built to address when we do have local transmission so that those teams can be deployed very readily. I think that we can learn a lot from Miami-Dade County, and one of the things that we can see is that because they disclose their cases to the public, as do we in Texas, that we can see where the cases are occurring in their counties in Florida. I think that we can also see the response to that local transmission, and it's a multi-pronged response with you know, trucks that are spraying, airplane, aerial spraying. They have people walking door to door. They're educating people and dealing with the habitat where the mosquitoes grow. So I think we're preparing for all of that. So I think that the state of Texas is doing what it's doing right now, which is prevention and planning and standing ready to respond when we do need to.
Representative Crownover, speaking of education efforts, public service announcements and the like, as we're in this preparedness phase, speaking with your constituents, do you sense that there is sort of that people are A, aware of what's going on, and B, is this actually a concern among the people that you represent?
Oh, absolutely. I've had a pregnant daughter-in-law all summer, and so we have talked about Zika a lot, and I think the general public, I think we've done a good job of getting it out to the general public. And but you know, I have been in Austin when the baby was born, but I woke up this morning in my own home and had been bitten by a mosquito during the night. So you can prepare and prepare. We had a great hearing on preparedness and what we do in the state of Texas. And one of the comments that came up was the county of, or city of Bastrop, you know, learned so much from the terrible fires that they had to go through. And so you go, wow, we're not going to let this happen again. We're going to be prepared. Well, 2 years later, it was a flood. So, you know, you prepare for Zika and you get Ebola. So it is very complicated, and we're going to have some. And we are. I'm impressed with what the state of Texas is doing. I talked with Matt Richardson, who is the head of Denton Health Department, and he said as soon as they know that they have a Zika confirmation, they are out there with a backpack with the DEET and the condoms, and then they have the, I've forgotten what he called it, backpack spray. So they spray, they educate that person if they have, and he stressed all of Texas's cases are imported. They're not created here. But to have that quick response is wonderful, but that we are not like Florida is really an act of luck. Not, I mean, you can't be so on top of it that it doesn't come to Texas.
In your conversations with the local health departments, do you what is sort of their main concern or their main need? Do you find that funding is still the top constraint, or?
I know exactly what their main concern is, and so Matt Richardson said, I think we've had 9 imported cases of Zika, and we have 18 of West Nile this year, and he said we can handle this, but if that doubled next year, they would not have the funding for it. So it is a very critical problem that we need to think about and be prepared for.
Right. And Mr. Thompson, speaking from on the ground, what are you saying?
Totally agree. We had presented to Chairwoman's committee on preparedness and basically stated, but let's put it this in context. So in 1999, we saw West Nile virus in New York. In 2002, we saw the first cases in Dallas County. So now we move to chikungunya, dengue, and now Zika. The common denominator is vaccine availability. West Nile virus, there's no human vaccine. They have vaccine for horses. We talk about Zika, similar. So where we have to be really on the frank conversation, it is not what the state is not doing, it's not what the feds are not doing. The reality is we have to put an emphasis on vector control in our local health departments throughout the United States. So if you're gonna tell us that the Zika virus in the coastal states is a challenge because of the AD species, then there needs to be funding available for vector control. $1.5 million that was appropriated is not enough for the state of Texas. So I want to be frank, because that's what this conversation should be about. It's not about what the state is not doing. It's not what the feds are not doing. It's clearly on a nation. We have to put more emphasis on vector control, because I've just pointed out the various vector-borne viruses that we're dealing with, and we're really fighting that with resources from our own cities, from our own counties, that city councils and county governments are really putting the money in and not getting the federal dollars that we should. So we're fighting this battle, but we're fighting a battle against this mosquito that is very elusive, very challenging.
Right. Well, I would like to point, sort of raise that priority to the academics on the panel. Vector control, I mean, is it realistic to prioritize that? You know, I think I've heard conflicting things. Some people say the Aedes aegypti mosquito is really difficult to spray for. It's more intensive. Do you see, realistically speaking, that we should be going after vector control as mission number one?
You know, from an infectious disease standpoint, the mosquito can transmit a lot of viruses that we know of, such as chikungunya, dengue, malaria, etc. But there are some other viruses that we may not hear about, which were discovered in Africa, in Asia, etc., that could be transmitted through these mosquitoes. So I agree that with vector control, you could prevent the spread of known as well as potentially other unknown viruses and other pathogens as well, parasites like malaria. So I think it's very, very important. The good thing about us here in the United States is our living conditions are different than overseas. We have houses with central air or air conditions. We have houses, many of them, that do have screens. You know, we have our cars, we have buildings. We don't leave large mounds of trash collecting in the streets or in the neighborhoods, etc. So we do have, we live in, you know, in areas where putting forth a very robust vector control program will work, because we have more defined spaces that we live in that mosquitoes find harder to reach. Of course, we have different types of mosquitoes. The mosquitoes that transmit West Nile, we can target those through aerial spraying. But you're right. The mosquitoes, the Aedes mosquito, basically evolved to coexist with humans. It evolved to live around our houses, not in the trees, biting the birds, and then coming down and biting us occasionally. No, it evolved to prefer biting us. So we are their main meal plan, unfortunately. And they love to stay in these enclosed areas, dark corners, pockets of water, buckets of water, tires, etc. And so because of that, yes, we will need a different strategy to target the control of this mosquito population than we would for the mosquitoes that transmit West Nile.
I mean, I completely agree that vector control is the place to be. I mean, again, it's fortunate we're talking about prevention, and so part of the prevention that we can do right now is sort of vector control as a community. So one of the things that people talk about is remember the D's, the three D's. Mm-hmm. So drain water around your house or your neighborhood. Dress, long sleeves, long pants if you're going to be outdoors, and then insect repellent containing DEET, the other D. So I think there's things that community members can do to help with vector control. And then I think part of any mosquito management plan involves disrupting the habitat where the mosquitoes live. And like you had said, they sort of evolved to cohabitate with us. They like to feed on us. Some believe exclusively on us, mm-hmm. and they live where we live. So they like the standing water, they like the tires that are sitting around the neighborhood, they like those sorts of things. And just, it all comes down to this. I mean, that some believe that the mosquito is one of the most efficient killing machines that the world has ever seen. And some believe that half of human deaths are due to diseases carried by mosquitoes. So yes, the common denominator, we don't have a vaccine for any of those, or at least we didn't when those outbreaks occurred. But you know, another common denominator is the vector. It's the mosquito and the Aedes aegypti mosquito. And one thing I would say when you apply the DEET, that this particular mosquito, it seems to like the ankles and feet. So be sure when you're applying the mosquito spray, not just to do the arms and neck, but also the ankles and the feet.
Representative Crownover, where do you see, you know, if we're putting a focus on vector control or, you know, Dr. Lee mentioned high quality housing, other sorts of priorities, these also sound expensive. And I just, speaking frankly, do you see, given that there hasn't necessarily been a crisis yet homegrown in Texas, do you think that there will actually be an appetite at the state legislature to spend money on these kinds of things?
Well, so I live in a very nice house and I was bitten by a mosquito this morning, so that shows the challenge that we all have. I was reading a book about hippopotamus to my 7-year-old grandson, and he asked me, he said, "Do you know what the most dangerous creature in the whole wide earth, is?" And I was thinking hippopotamus versus rhinoceros, because I'd heard one was mean and one was not so mean. And I said, "No, what?" And he said, "The mosquito. It is the most dangerous. There are 400,000 people that die, and mostly children and old people, that die of malaria every year." So, you know, the big picture on this global world where people and equipment and supplies travel nation to nation and continent to continent as easily as we used to go to Denton, Texas, can, in our global economy, can we coexist with mosquitoes? And there is precedent in that I was from a ranch family and we used to have to dip cattle every year. And they discovered, because of the screwworm. Mm-hmm. And so they discovered the male screwworm flies. You probably know a boatload about that, and I don't. But that is no longer a problem. But there are consequences of that, and then when we solve that problem, then the deer herd came back. Everybody says, "Where are all these deer in Texas that used to not be?" So it's because of that. So I said, "Well, why don't we just wipe out all the mosquitoes in the world?" And they said, "The birds would starve." I don't know. It's very common. The Texas is looking at it. One of the low-hanging fruit is the tires that we've always known we should take care of. We've always known that was a problem. They have an initiative to address that now. So it's has a big old price tag with it.
Yeah. Well, and speaking of sort of legislative approaches to combating the disease. You know, one of the things that stands out about Texas, of course, is that we have such a high rate of people without health insurance. I wonder, Mr. Thompson, in your dealings, how do you even try to solve a public health problem when you've got substantial populations that are not covered and maybe not routinely getting medical care?
Well, we have to look at it two sides. One, even on the infectious disease perspective, the cost associated with treating for vector-borne illnesses is astronomical. So we really have to look at the cost. We're going to spend the money whether the federal government sends the dollars or not. That money is going to be spent by local public health hospitals. And so the taxpayers are going to foot the bill for the recovery process of these individuals. So when you look at it, 600,000 uninsured residents in Dallas County, that's a concern. But the real concern is that the population, you got 80% of the individuals who could get bitten by a mosquito carrying the Zika virus that won't even exemplify any symptoms. And so the challenge is, this is where the localized approach that we have to deal with. So one, most people, it's going to be such mild symptoms, they're not going to even think to go to a doctor. Secondly, if they go to a physician, in a 1 mile radius, if you take the example of Miami-Dade County, in a 1 mile radius of 500 to 1,000 houses, can you imagine how many personnel is going to be required to walk door to door to give out Zika prevention kits, to interview these individuals, pick up samples, take them back to a lab? The cost that keeps going up. So the reality is, you asked about uninsured, but we're going to pay for it regardless whether they're uninsured or insured based on the response effort. But if you look at West Nile virus in terms of the neuroinvasive, that cost is extremely high. On Zika, and I'll say one last piece on this, it is unacceptable for one mother to have to carry a baby full term to make decisions, not only financially and emotionally, about the baby that will come from her to make a decision on that life-changing experience based on the Zika virus. It's worth the cost.
Do you see Medicaid expansion as a way of containing costs, or is this a separate discussion? I mean, realistically speaking, if people had insurance,
and I think so, but we get into politics on that. So I wanted to stay away from that, but you brought it up. I'll leave it alone.
I will say this, though. You know, the cost of prevention, it certainly is substantial, but the cost of some of the complications of Zika are very substantial. So one of the big reasons we're so concerned about Zika is not so much the acute infection that one of us might have, but the fact that it can result in microcephaly in infants. And the cost associated, the emotional cost and the cost of families is astronomical, but to put a dollar figure on it, the March of Dimes believes that the lifetime cost of caring for a child with microcephaly is around $10 million. So if you want to look at cost, the cost of the complications are really the cost that we will pay for if we don't invest the funds in prevention right now.
Mm-hmm. And I agree. You know, as a mom of four kids, all under the age of 9, who are coming in with mosquito bites every day, I do worry about these babies who are born with microcephaly. Imagine they're going to need, especially if they have severe disease, it can range a spectrum of mild to severe disease. If they have severe disease, they're going to need a pediatrician who's going to follow them closely. They're going to need speech therapy. They're going to need occupational therapy. They're going to need physical therapy. They're going to need almost round-the-clock care and assistance to help them do simple things like walk or feed themselves, etc. And the psychological toll that takes on especially a young family, they're looking forward to their first baby, not even imagining that this baby of theirs may not be able to take care of themselves 10 or 20 years down the line. That's a huge cost to our society, and I agree. If we can prevent that one infected mosquito from hitting that one pregnant woman, that's completely worth it to me.
Well, if you have one, you get just one sort of recommendation to make, a policy change that could improve prevention, what would it be in an ideal world? And I'll leave this open to anyone.
Well, I'll start out. I think you hit on Medicaid expansion. We really need to revisit that. I know that's a political discussion, but bottom line, as I dialogue with health directors across the state of Texas, as I dialogue with my counterparts throughout the nation, vector control as it relates to putting an emphasis, and I just spelled out, and you're right, there are many other vector-borne diseases. We're talking about Zika, started in 1947 when we started looking at it. Here it is 2016, and we're going into 2017. And so the issue is that vector control, I go back to my original point, we have to focus. When we did not have these vector-borne diseases as rampant as we see them now, the funding was reduced. And so we left on our own to fight this battle. And so in a policy aspect, I hope that's a continued discussion at the state legislature, at the federal government, but I'll reiterate my point. $1.5 million for the state of Texas is clearly not enough to fight Zika.
You know, from the standpoint of being an infectious disease doctor, what I think is really important is when we're dealing with these new diseases or even emerging or known diseases, being able to test quickly for them and to test easily for them, I think is really important. And for me, it's not acceptable to tell a pregnant woman, yes, we think you might have Zika, but we can't tell you until a week or so from now because it takes that long to get the test processed and run. And so I think being able to give our local health departments that capability for expansion, for being able to bring tests on board quickly, pushing them out in real time, and for making tests like this available to the populations at risk. Is it going to be kids? Is it going to be pregnant women? Is it going to be older patients, et cetera? Which neighborhoods, et cetera? I think that's very, very important. So one thing I'm really glad about is that here in Texas, we are now testing our blood units. And that's very important for me because I take care of transplant patients. And we know that West Nile virus was transmitted through blood transfusions to transplant donors. So imagine, again, another situation where you or a loved one has received a life-saving organ, only to find out that this person who just got a new heart or a new kidney or liver now has West Nile virus neuroinvasive disease and may have died from it. That's, I think, really important.
I think for me, I think that the rapid diagnostics are certainly of paramount importance. I think that we're lucky if we get the results in the week now. You know, some women are waiting months to hear the results. And, you know, it has to be tested for very rapidly. So if we don't do the blood test within about a week, maybe 2 weeks of when someone has exposure, then, you know, we cannot detect it. And so we have to use other tests to look for antibodies and things of that sort. And there's some cross-reactivity between those antibody tests, between dengue and Zika. So there's some specificity issues. There's certainly a rapid diagnostic issue there. I personally think the number one thing we can do is vector control. I think that is really of great importance.
And what would that look like? I mean, how do you, if you're making a pitch to the legislature, for example, and they have a set amount of money to spend on vector control, what concrete things should they be doing?
Well, I think that supporting some of the efforts that the local health departments are doing is critically important. So I think some of the local health departments in the state of Texas have taken it upon themselves to, and they're doing the right things. It's just that it's very costly. So some of the local health departments, I think, you know, they're doing this from other budgets, and there is a need for support from the federal government, which now we have passed a bill, but it's going to take a while for the money to get to the states and the local government. So I think that we do have a good grip on what to do. I think it's just very costly. And the last thing I would say is that I think that development of a vaccine is critically important. So in the 60s, we were dealing with rubella, and you know, and so fortunately, we were able to develop a vaccine to where now in the United States, you know, that is not a concern the way it was back in the 60s. There's still 100,000 children who develop rubella every year worldwide because they don't have access to the vaccine. But I think that Zika, I think it's here to stay, and I think that it will show up or local transmission in Texas, and I think we do need a vaccine long term. So I think that's part of this process as well.
Representative Crownover?
Well, it's kind of interesting to listen to these people that are on the front line and dealing with this, and then to know the political situations that happen. So, you know, if we had to vector control, of course. I don't know in our global world that we can live with mosquitoes. But there will be a group that's wanting to protect the mosquitoes. There's always a group. So, and the groups have learned to be very passionate and very vocal. So there will be a protect the mosquito group, save the birds. Just like we come up with a vaccine and we have the groups out there. Of course, the autism, people still think vaccines cause autism. So we have the anti-vax people, we have the save the birds, we have the save the mosquitoes. It's very hard. To proceed, just like I bet everybody read about all the horses that the United States is feeding right now instead of putting them down because they're old or mean.
So do you find today's political climate to be one of the biggest obstacles to really, you know, tackling public health?
Sometimes I think common sense is under attack right now. So,
well.
And everybody has their example of how common sense is just absolutely under attack. And
well, I would like to just continue talking about sort of political ramifications when it comes to public health. I think the other big access question that I would be remiss not to ask about is contraception and women's health in Texas. Obviously an intense, politically charged debate, but then we have, you know, viruses like Zika, which, it, you know, for the time being, at least it seems like really pregnant women and the infants are really the most at risk here. To everybody on the panel, do you see that there has been a detrimental effect as far as our ability to combat Zika, given the kind of political climate around women's health?
maybe I'll address a little bit of it this way, and others can chime in. But you know, one of the unique things about this particular mosquito-borne illness is that the Zika virus can cross the placenta and cause harm to the child. So we're talking about not only the mother but the child. And then another unique feature is that it can be transmitted sexually. And you know, at first we thought, well, you know, only the mosquito can transmit the virus. Then we thought, well, just the mother to child can transmit the virus. Then we thought only men could transmit it to women. Then we found out, no, women can also transmit it to sexual partners as well. So, you know, we're finding new things about this all the time. But certainly, you know, condoms as a means to prevent sexual transmission of the Zika virus, I think is an appropriate recommendation. I think that's part of this. And
more effective than, say, abstinence education?
Well, obviously not. Well, not more effective than abstinence. So not more effective than abstinence. So the one way to prevent sexual transmission of Zika is to not have sex. But, you know, I think condoms are part of prevention plan for people who do choose to have sex. And so that is part of this. And that is a unique feature of Zika that we didn't see with some of the other mosquito-borne illnesses to date.
Yeah, this is one of the, I agree, this is one of the first mosquito-borne viruses that's transmitted sexually. And now, besides telling everyone, please don't be bitten by a mosquito, avoid mosquito bites, or if you've just come back from a Zika area in Latin America or Caribbean, don't let our Texas mosquitoes bite you for 21 days. Besides that, we are saying to women, avoid unprotected sex for up to 8 weeks. If you think you've been exposed to Zika or if you have it. And for men, we've extended that even beyond. Every time that I talk about Zika to an audience, I feel like I have to add a few months. First it was 2 months, then 4, now 6 months. We're saying for men who have partners and are considering building their own family, they have to avoid, either through abstinence or through condom use, unprotected sex because of that risk of transmission. So this is unprecedented. I don't think we've ever encountered this type of situation. I don't think we even predicted it. And you know, the more that we learn about the virus, the more we learn about other transmission means.
To again, stay out of the politics of that question, I want to make sure it's clear. When you look at the communities that we walk in each day to do education, these are poor areas. These are areas where people can't take off from work to go to the doctor. Women health has to be a priority to the various cultures that we have in Dallas County and throughout the state of Texas. And I think what we're getting is when there's a cut in funding or an issue with a organization, that takes away from those low-income women who were getting information, who were getting services. And so that's what we're seeing. And I agree, common sense is uncommon. And so that's really the issue, that when you talk about women's health, we see a lot of cuts that are associated with women's health, but it's hitting, while it's across the board in terms of women, low-income women get hit the hardest.
I am optimistic about the Healthy Texas Women rollout, where we have taken down some of the silos where, you know, you can't do this and you can't do that. So I hope we have streamlined that process. I hope it will give our departments of health a much better, improved tool. There are also improved tools like the LARCs, the long-acting reversible contraceptives, that are proving to be excellent and it's kind of something that people need to invest in and think about and make other people aware of. So they are reversible, and that's the big end.
But there was also that study recently from UT that found that after the 2011 cuts that the use of larks had fallen. I mean, do you think there will be more political willpower to invest in, you know, things like the Healthy Texas Women's Program because of Zika? Do you see those as being connected?
Well, they are connected. I mean, this is an economic connection. I would hate to have a resort in Puerto Rico right now for honeymoons. You know, it's just not, it's better to go skiing now or something. So there are all sorts of ramifications, but I visited with our FQHC, and they say the larks are available. They are, I was making sure that there weren't any roadblocks, and they are very optimistic about that being a tool, an improved tool that we have not had before.
We've got about 5 minutes left before we open it up to audience questions. I'd encourage everyone to come line up behind the microphones. I just have one quick question, and then hopefully we'd love to incorporate some audience questions. But while they are lining up, just one last thing for the panel. Texas, I think, took a relatively unprecedented step in, as was mentioned earlier, offering mosquito repellent coverage through Medicaid as a way of getting these sort of lower income, more at-risk communities, you know, access to kind of preventive care. That benefit expires in 2 weeks at the end of the month. But we've heard on the panel that I think the general consensus is that Zika is going to be here for a little while, certainly beyond October 31st. Do you think that benefit should stay in place or that there should be others like it? Where do you see sort of Medicaid's ability to, you know, tackle public health? Well, you each have 30 seconds.
Well, it should continue, bottom line. I'm glad they took the restriction about having to go and get a doctor's statement. So that was a good catch.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, we may not need mosquito spray as much in December or January, but they come back every year as far as I've been here. The mosquitoes will always come back. So I think it is a benefit for not only the mom, but who does a mom use a mosquito spray on her kids as well? So I think there'll be, you know, family-wide benefits in maintaining this.
I think it's fabulous that the state of Texas invested in prevention, and I think we should continue to do that. The mosquitoes, this particular type of mosquito has been here for 200 years. It's going to be here after the 2 months of cold weather that we get this year in Texas. So yes, there will still be a need for insect repellent.
Well, the insect repellent, you could think of that as an ounce of prevention versus the $10 million,
yes,
not even a cure, not a cure, but just a stopgap on a tragedy. Mm-hmm. So, yes.
Yeah, you're in favor of the benefit.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
So, well, maybe if we want to talk about other sort of, you know, long-term kind of investments. I'm curious about vaccines. I mean, is it premature to be talking about vaccines right now? Do you see, is this an opportunity for the state to invest in research to that effect, or is that more of a pipe dream?
Well, we don't have a vaccine currently approved, but there are at least four groups that are developing different types of vaccines. And there's a lot of optimism this go round that we will be able to develop a vaccine. It has to do with the genetics of this particular virus as compared to some others. So vaccines for viruses are often problematic because of the complexity and the way that the virus changes. But there's a lot of optimism for Zika. And there's a belief that at least one of these vaccines will be approved in 2017, which is really unprecedented in terms of how quick an approval can occur. We think of drugs taking 15 to 20 years to be approved. Vaccines take 4 to 6 years in some cases. So to have a vaccine in 18 to 24 months would be wonderful. And I think there's a lot of optimism given some of the new technologies that are being developed to create vaccines.
Do you share that optimism, Dr. Lee?
I agree too. You know, with these vaccine candidates that are available right now, I mean, the fact that they're testing them in humans at this point in time, I mean, last summer we hadn't really heard of Zika, and now suddenly it's on our radar. We're worried about it. Summer, I guess, of 2015, and suddenly to have a vaccine that is already being administered in humans is unprecedented, and I think that really says a lot about the academic and the medical communities, in that these different communities were able, these different institutions were able to mobilize their resources, communicate and share information with each other, especially samples with researchers and medical facilities in Brazil as well as Latin America. It's unprecedented, I agree.
I think in the long term, we're moving toward not only from what you have to face in infectious disease control, but we're gonna have to focus on aerial lava siting is another option that funding should be available from the feds to local health departments. You hear a lot about pesticide. We hear a lot about the aerial spraying from pesticide, adult siding, and that's where you have a lot of pushback, where people say you have to protect the bees, you gotta protect in terms of what kind of side effects it could have. One of the areas we're exploring is, and they did this in Miami-Dade County, where they went in with not only the pesticide, but aerial lava siting, where they kill the mosquitoes in the lava so it doesn't grow into an adult mosquito. That's another prevention effort that, again, goes back to vector control. That's gonna be more expensive on the lava siting than it is adult siting, but it's a critical point to kill the mosquitoes before they become adults. Hmm.
So Walter, this is a very quiet group, so I'll kick the question off since this is the quietest I've ever seen. So I sit on the Dallas Regional Chamber Board, and I love living in North Texas, and in the last 4 years we've recruited 200 new corporate headquarters to Dallas. 100 of those are from California, which is kind of cool, and I know that always makes us proud when we're Texans talking like that. But when we go and recruit those corporate headquarters, one of the things that I always question is people start talking about living in North Texas. So give us a little optimism if we're out selling in corporate headquarters. Is this a safe place to live and a safe place to move your workforce? And are we making the investments that we need to make those companies feel safe to invest their dollars and move their employees, many of which are in tech and are younger populations, to North Texas?
Well, definitely. This is a safe place to. I've lived in Dallas all my life, so of course I'm just go Dallas and Dallas County. But when you talk about businesses who are relocating here, when you look at the issues that we're facing is what they're facing wherever they're coming from. I think the concern is that when you look at the number of people, just take away the businesses, when you look at the number of people who are relocating to this area, while we may have the high tech, the millennials, we're also having those who are poor who have no coverage from health standpoint. But when you put us all together, this still is a healthy North Texas that makes it attractive for businesses. You got UT Southwestern, you got Parkland, the best public health hospital. Whether you move around from Dallas, Denton, Collin County, you basically have a good workforce as well as a great environment and a great infrastructure. I think what we're talking about is what everyone is facing. If I'm in Miami-Dade, they lost money in terms of the Zika response that's going on. What you have here and what you have on this panel, from the state legislature all the way to individuals who are involved in their various entities, is a quick response right along with Baylor, Parkland, all of the hospitals, Blue Cross Blue Shield, everybody working together when there is a disaster, when there is a timely response. And I think that's the selling point, that there's not been a situation that we've not been able to respond to when we're faced with adversity.
Yeah, I agree. You know, I've lived in many places throughout my life. I grew up in West Africa. I've lived in other states, etc. And this is an easy city to live in. It's a family-friendly city. That's why I have four kids here, you know. It's a diverse city. It is a city with a tremendous amount of resources. And you've got an academic medical center with many private health centers. And we work together and we communicate very well. closely with each other, and in the Academic Medical Center, we communicate very closely with the health department. I have certain people on my speed dial when I'm suspecting unusual infections, and they have me as well on speed dial. And so what I'd say is this, look, we were able to nip the West Nile epidemic in 2012. We had the first case of Ebola here in Dallas, Texas, and did it spread into the suburbs, as everyone feared? I remember hearing people say, well, I didn't take a plane that would stop in the Dallas-Fort Worth airport because I was worried about Ebola. No, we were able to mobilize with that. We are able at this time, to prevent we haven't had a large outbreak of locally transmitted Zika as had been predicted earlier in the spring. So we definitely have the resources here in Dallas as well as in Texas to deal with these things. And you know, the governor's task force on infectious diseases, this is why we are here. This is why you have so many professionals from so many different professions, you know, pharmacy, health department, local municipalities, et cetera. We're all here putting our heads together to make sure that there is no large-scale infectious disease, apocalypse that will occur in our area.
I guess I grew up in Central Texas and now live in San Antonio, so my comments will apply to several Texas cities. But Texas is a fabulous place to have your family and have your children grow up. And for me personally, I've been very proud that the state has invested so heavily in cancer research, in emergency preparedness for infectious diseases. We have a relatively mild climate, friendly people. We have a spirit of collaboration. And so I think that when it comes to health and it comes to science, some of the investments that the state has made make me very proud to be a Texan.
I would echo that in that we have the honor of being Texans. And so we get where we take what we have around us for granted. Doesn't everybody have a UT Southwestern in their state? Doesn't everybody have an MD Anderson? No, and all over the world, people come from Saudi Arabia, Switzerland, Africa, to our health institutions. But I have been so impressed with the boots on the ground, with our health departments. You know, you go, oh, who are they? What did they do? When you go visit them and you see who they are and you see their sense of mission and they know that they are protecting all the citizens of our state, they are delightful people. They are well-informed. They are very creative people, and I just feel blessed to have them.
But let me follow that up with, is the takeaway then from this summer sort of, you know, highest risk chance time of Zika, that we did everything right and that we're walking away confident that everything's taking, you know, under control? Because maybe it's just me, but I don't know that I necessarily...
I think we're fortunate that we got a bird's eye view of Miami-Dade County to really look at retooling. If you look at vector control and the response effort, we need businesses to educate their employees. We need civic groups, churches, everyone involved in this process. And I think we got another chance next mosquito season, but we have to start now. And the key point that was brought up, I mean, what's a winter in North Texas? We don't really have a winter. And so the issue is that when the mosquitoes, are you talking 60 degrees and above, they're active. And so in Dallas County, in North Texas, we may have to use mosquito repellent almost all year round, depending on what the temperature for that day.
Well, let's take an audience question.
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Sarah Delrin-Pineda. Thank you for coming today. This was very timely for us. I'm the executive director for Blue Cross of Texas for our Star Kids program, so very active with our Medicaid membership. And at Blue Cross, we've been giving out mosquito repellent and educating our members since before the state mandated to make repellent a covered benefit for Medicaid. And we were very happy to see that, because especially for the Star Kids program in Texas, which Texas really is a leader in, right, across the nation for having a Medicaid program to specifically serve children with high risk and special health care needs, which often these, you know, unfortunately these Zika babies will fall, many of them will fall into that population and will be caring for many years to come. We were happy to see that the repellent and all of the state's work in trying to educate the population. But with this legislative session coming up, Representative, I was wondering what you thought, what's the feel from a political standpoint and the funding that it requires to continue this type of work around prevention and how possibly we may help and educating and getting the word out. I think in Texas it's important for people to understand how this, you know, this money for prevention really saves us all in the long run.
Well, that's a huge question. it's an enormous question. We do have challenges this time with the oil and gas revenues coming in, and we gave the $4 billion tax cut last time that maybe some of us were wishing we had to use this time. It is going to be a challenge, but it's the ounce of prevention. The cure is just unthinkable when you have microcephaly, and we have to be diligent on that, and we have to find out. But just like Matt Richards from the director from Denton said, we handle those 9 cases this year, but we wouldn't have money to handle, you know, twice that many, and that's a possibility. So we're going to have to be aware of that, and each person talk to their legislators and make sure that they understand how important it is. Thank you.
And with that, I think we're about out of time, but just wanted to thank you all for having us, and please thank the panelists for being here. Thank you. Thank you.